Greetings, Guardians. My name is Bife here. Today we're getting back to our series of videos where we discuss the fate of Prince Aldrin. This series of videos is one I started a very long time ago. There is only one part of this series so far, but if you want to catch up on that one part, you can find it in the end card. To give you a brief summary though, Aldrin's relationship with Mara is what's primarily being explored, and it revolves, in the most part, around this big notion that she doesn't quite see him at his full potential. He can never surprise her. She is expectant of everything. She knows everything. Aldrin wants to be respected, but he wants to please Mara and go above and beyond by surprising her with his skills and competence. His plan for proving this was to take one of the best crow marksmen that was around, Jolyon Tyldorakis, and to use their combined skills to enter the Black Garden. Upon reaching the gate of the Black Garden, there was a problem, namely the Vex and Cabal that were milling around the gate and making accessing it so hard. Two heavily armed forces at war make it hard for anyone to survive outside of a Guardian, but Aldrin has a plan. A plan that unfolded like this. They crawl belly down across the Martian desert like worms. Active camouflage ponchos break up their outlines. The roaming Cabal harvesters growl on the horizon. For the last 8 hours, Jolyon has been picking off Cabal infantry with his rifle, fleeing the eruption of automatic counterfire. Aldrin has listened on cracked battle nets as mightier weapons are invoked and brought to bear. The war machine is now inflamed, swollen with outrage. Jolyon touches Aldrin's ankle. Fingertips drum out a code. How far? 50 meters, Aldrin whispers. If the Vex know we're here, they haven't... The air prickles. Subsonic groans of power stir in the sand. Something mighty awakens above them. Never mind, Aldrin mutters. The Vex have now reacted. He throws off his poncho, rising with revolver and deflection grenade in his fists, screaming challenge. Jutting from the Martian desert before them is the canted, frigid hoop that is the Black Garden's gate, huge enough to swallow a fallen skiff. It thrills with energy. Out of that aperture emerges the behemoth silhouette of a Vex gate lord. Metal and mind crashing together, self-assembling, ready to defend this secret place. The Vex are born here, in the sense of baptism, consecrated to service of some terrible purpose that the machines found within. Hey, big guy, Aldrin shouts, over here. Calmly, carefully, Jolyon Tyldorakis begins to fire his rifle straight up into the sky. The reports of the Supremacy's huge cartridges spill out across the dunes. The Gate Lord towers above them. Aldrin whoops and hip-fires a couple of rounds into the sand at its feet. Can you dance, sir? He bellows. Have you got the footwork? Inside the Vex entity, there are mighty algorithms constructing a model of this merely temporal place, calculating potential threat, weighing the utility of weapons discharge against the good that power might do elsewhere. This computation is the only reason Aldrin's still alive. The bone mic tuned to Cabal tactical channels wakes up at Aldrin's throat. They have localized the sound of Jolyon's rifle and are responding. He hollers up at the Vex behemoth and starts to jig. It's going to rain on Mars. It's monsoon season in Meridian Bay. Did you see the forecast? He grabs Joel by the hand and pulls. Together they sprint towards the Gate Lord and its charge. The Vex machine must know what's coming, but it has to weigh the certainty of Cabal against the tiny possibility of these microbiotic motes slipping into the gate. The Gate Lord raises a weapon to obliterate them. They skid into the gate's threshold, and Aldrin activates the deflection grenade so hard he nearly breaks his thumb. A perfect sphere of topologically deflective space-time blinks into being around him. He holds Jolyon close, and together, they calm their breath. The barrier is impenetrable, but it will not last long. Until then, there is only so much air to breathe. Outside, the full fury of a Cabal fleet carrier lands on the Gate Lord. When the barrier fades, the Gate Lord is dead, and Aldrin and Jolyon are no longer on Mars. When the pair reemerge, the world around them is unrecognizable from what it once was. There in the Black Garden, the supposed birthplace of the Vex, where Pujari landed as he dove from the cliffs of the Shores of Time, the place where we first conquered the darkness, the place where the strength of the Virgo Prohibition is at its apex. But instead of Vex or us, or Pujari or anyone else who has explored the garden, this is not their story. This is Aldrin's. This is before the Dark Heart has been destroyed. This is what happened next. Aldrin and Jolyon huddle together, shivering beneath a canopy of white tongues. The rain pours down. Aldrin can't tell where it comes from, exactly. Somewhere up in the green mist? But the rain falls and falls, and he and Jolyon turn their heads up to drink. Here, at the bottom of a chasm beneath two flower fields, where the garden's immaculate surface divides into tropical feta. Everything grows here, Jolyon mutters. Look at your nails. Aldrin studies his hand. He has a dreadful image of his fingernails developing into tight, down-curved loops that curl around back into his fingers, completing a hideous circuit to their root. It's awful, and yet it's wonderful, in a transgressive way, in a newborn screaming way. It speaks to him of new and secret things happening here. They're dirty, he says. But I trust you'll forgive me on that account. Rain's not letting up. Shall we move? Aye. Jolyon hauls himself up with a fistful of slithering vines. They try to coil around his wrist. Tiny teeth snapped like letters sore at his skin. He stares at them, starts to say something, and jerks his arm away. Are you all right? For now, Jolyon mutters. For now. They move down the length of the chasm, green mist swirling overhead, ankle deep in a wet compost of flower petals and rich black soil. Wide, flat beetles with arching horns wrestle in the earth. Aldrin flips one on its back. The beetle has no interior seen from below. It is just a hollow shell. Jolyon pulls up a fern, and its roots are the branching metallic threads of a circuit board. Tiny squirming things shaped like wet microchips mill in the exposed soil. I don't like this place, Jolyon whispers. We should get back to the surface. He means the garden's surface, the manicured sectors of red flowers that stretch away towards a distant mesa. But it's far too Vex up there, Aldrin thinks. They've been in here, gardening, moving earth, making walls, building their ancient constructs of stone and light, trying to tame this place. It's life, he breathes. You're right, Jol. Everything grows here. He cannot let this place be killed. He cannot let it be looted and overthrown like everything else that doesn't fit into the narrow binary dogmas of the Traveler's undead warriors. Excitement seizes him, and he runs ahead, sloshing through the muck, laughing aloud. Aldrin! Jolyon shouts after him. What are you looking for? I don't know, he cries back. That's what's so incredible. I can't know. Aldrin's fascination with the garden is evident, and it gives us a clear indication of what it means to him to be here. It's a great moment for him to show his potential competence to Mara. He is in a place so unexplored that it leaves him baffled. It leaves him excited with joyous ideas of what this place might be, but it also leaves him defensive against those that might cause another incursion, or those who have already been conducting it. In the case of one group of Cabal, This wrath that he is beginning to develop on behalf of the garden where things grow starts to flourish in its entirety. They track the last Cabal soldier from the place of carnage onward through the flower fields, following the dribble of black oil that escapes the wounded legionary's pressure tourniquet. Aldrin moves with cold, vicious anger. War here in the garden. Petty, detestable war, brought into this place by some blundering Cabal expedition. They deserve what they got. The garden must be left to tend itself, mustn't it? It must be allowed to evolve its secret fruits. The terrain dips. The red flowers fade away to low, woven grass. The wind whispers. Soft words, sentences, with just the beginnings of syntax. The cadence almost musical. Brainstain, Jolyon whispers, fearing infection by a contagious idea. We should... But his voice trails off as Aldrin pushes ahead, down into a low vale, slipping easily through tangled undergrowth. Vex. There are Vex here. Dozens of goblins and minotaurs, still as statues and covered in moss, in a ring like some robotic henge. They are singing in faint, wraith-like notes of inhuman clarity. Aldrin knows what this place must be. The Cabal legionary huddles behind a stone. Aldrin creeps forward. By the time the wounded, bellowing thing knows he's there, he has a knife pressed to its helmet, right above the cleft of its lips and the soft tissues below. Don't move, he says in Ulurunt. Don't speak. This knife is atom sharp. I can tell, the legionary grunts in its native tongue. It's right up in my eyes, practically shaving me bristles. Now you know where you are. Just about the worst place anyone's ever gone. You say that because you can't smell the air, Aldrin says. It's sweet, like pollen and thunder. Why did you come here?
Not by any chance of our own, sir. The milk robots abducted us.
The whispers have taken on a soft hint of Ulurant grammar, confirming Aldrin's suspicions. This is a place where abstract patterns war for survival, fighting to propagate themselves by preying on each other. The Vex are singing to see how the garden changes their song, and even this conversation has fertilized the air. Why are they here? What do they want?
They come here to pray, sir. They're making vessel out of themselves. They're the worst things ever to be, sir. They hate existence.
How do you know this?
Oh, from the seeds, sir,
the legionary says.
Do you see them?
And without hesitation or second thought, he punches the emergency medic release on his helmet. The pressure seal breaks, and a ring of black gel sprays out, hissing. The legionary slumps over. His helmet tumbles into his broad lap. Beneath the layer of gel, the whole surface of his skull has the pitted texture of a strawberry. Thousands of tiny seeds glisten in the Cabal's flesh. Aldrin brushes the skin in fascination.
Aldrin, Jolyon radios. I don't like the expression on your face.
This place has secrets, the prince murmurs back. The bone mic feels cold and inorganic, poorly matted to his flesh, compared to the warm, close-packed pits of the legionary's deformed skull. So many secrets. They grew in him, Jolyon. The garden grew its secrets in him. Who gives a rat? Jolyon snaps. Your Highness, we've got to get out of here before whatever happened to them happens to us. He's afraid of secrets. Aldrin realizes. The unknown terrifies him, which is very sensible. Very rational. The attitude of a good scout, a good soldier, a survivor. But Aldrin can't stop imagining how astonished Mara would be at this place. What if he could bring her here? What if they could explore this place together? Aldrin's story of the incursion into the Black Garden ends here, and presumably both him and Jolyon escape the strange Vex underworld. As in the next entry, we see that Aldrin has returned to Mara, having hand-picked flowers from the garden, flowers that grow in the Dreaming City to this day. That entry is one we will follow up on in another video coming soon. But I want to let you guys know we are going to continue this series on quite seriously. There's a lot for us to cover, there's a lot for us to get through, and there's a lot of these videos that you can expect to see in the weeks to come. Not just from the Forsaken Prince lore books, but also from other parts of Forsaken. As you guys know, about a year ago, just as Forsaken was coming out in October, I took a break. I took a month-long break so that I could recover, so that I didn't burn out entirely. And that meant that I missed a substantial amount of Forsaken content. The cool thing about that now is that we're going to be able to cover it in this break as we go up to Shadowkeep. And when we are sufficiently covered, and when I've covered enough of the topics and I feel like there is enough knowledge, there will indeed be videos on Shadowkeep, including some pretty massive projects, but regardless, that's stuff going on anyway, at a later date. Next week I am going to be at Gamescom, as a quick little note and announcement for you guys. I will try and make sure that the content schedule is planned out as usual. The plan at current for me is to record a bit of content surrounding Lumina. That may be a very long video. If that is a very long video, we will try to get it to you on the weekend, or we will try to get it to you later down the line next week. Regardless of what happens, you'll also be able to catch other videos. I want to make a channel update and get that out there for next weekend, and I want to make sure that we have some other content to tide you over while I'm away in Germany. But regardless of any of that, thank you so much for showing up to the videos still, and thank you so much for all the support and for everybody's kind words when it came to topics like this. But anyway, thank you very much, of course, also for being around and enjoying the video, and if you did, go ahead and do all the typical YouTube stuff, you know how it is. Like the video, subscribe if you're so inclined for more content, hit the bell if you really don't want to miss a video, and then of course, the comments section is open for your own commentary down below. But as always, know that your viewership is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Purudasya Ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.